Welcome to part 6 of CollabNet's Scrum training series, the Sprint Retrospective Meeting. The retrospective is the very last step of the Scrum cycle after the Sprint Review Meeting. The empirical feedback from the Sprint Review Meeting should influence the retrospective discussions. The Sprint Review Meeting was our chance to inspect and adapt the product. Now the Sprint Retrospective Meeting is the team's chance to inspect and adapt its process. The retrospective is the key for using Scrum as a framework for learning, rather than the stale defined processes we usually see. In a complex world, only learning teams and learning organizations will thrive. The Scrum Master's goal is to create the conditions for a learning team and eventually a learning organization. According to The Skill Facilitator by Roger Schwarz, the facilitator does not intervene directly in the content of a group's discussion. To do so would be to abandon neutrality and reduce the group's responsibility for solving its problems. The Scrum Master's listening and facilitation skills in this meeting make a big difference. Even in a team that's declared as self-organizing, status affects all transactions. Also, some people have a greater tendency to form opinions and vocalize them before others have figured out how they feel. An effective facilitator sometimes uses status leveling techniques to reveal a greater cross-section of viewpoints from the team. In this module, I'll show you my own interpretation of techniques I found useful. Since I may do things differently than the inventors of these techniques may have intended, at the end I'll refer you to the original sources. As usual, I'll quiz you along the way. Most people understand that a team will only have candid dialogue in an environment of psychological safety. But when someone feels safe in an interaction, they often make the mistake of assuming everyone else is equally safe. A good facilitator knows this is rarely the case. Rather than make assumptions, I suggest Scrum Masters start with an anonymous safety check. We'll watch our Scrum Master follow a safety check procedure recommended by a facilitator named Steven Smith.
We're going to do a safety check before the main part of the retrospective. I'm giving each of you a blank ballot. Hang on to them for a minute. Think about a situation in your life where you felt unsafe, uncomfortable, or awkward. Now bring yourself back to the most comfortable and relaxed situation you can remember. Now I'm going to ask you how you feel right now in this room doing this retrospective. Please write a number from the safety gradient and fold it so others cannot read it. Even those who feel safe should not reveal their choice to protect the anonymity of those who don't. Now I'll collect and tally your votes. Please put them in the hat.
A couple weeks ago, I dropped in on a retrospective for a group that said they were, quote, doing Scrum, even though they had about 15 people in the room, no clear idea who was on the team, and accountability to people other than the product owner. One last point on safety. You've probably heard a productive conversation at work stop as soon as the boss walks in the room, but subordinates sometimes do see it because they realize the company has given the boss power over who gets promotions, who's retained in the event of a layoff, etc. Concern about looking good for the boss can color subordinate interactions with each other in ways that might not align with optimal team self-organization. Also, the presence of someone who has traditionally been responsible for their work has sometimes kept teams from taking as much responsibility as they might otherwise. It can be hard to see these effects because people don't admit to themselves they're happening. One group I worked with was so concerned with this problem, they put their managers on different teams than their subordinates. According to Roger Schwarz, members often begin solving problems by suggesting solutions before agreeing on the problem or its causes. A Scrum Master can help with this problem by keeping the group on the same step. For example, some facilitators like to keep the group in distinct steps for objective questions, such as what happened, reflective questions, such as how do we feel about it, interpretive questions, such as what does it mean, and decision questions, such as what are we going to do about it. Professional negotiator William Urey gets people to focus on their interests rather than bargaining from particular positions. And marriage researcher John Gottman finds couples are more likely to stay married if they learn to start negotiating from their core interests rather than pushing for particular outcomes. The common element to remember from all experts is to make sure decisions about actions come last. In the next chapter, we'll see an example technique to help with this.
I've given each of you a stack of post-it notes. I'd like you to spend 10 minutes writing one observation per post-it note about the previous sprint. Write them down, whether they're good, bad, neutral, and don't worry about categorizing them yet. Hold off on discussing them until everyone's done writing. When you get stuck, consider writing down the things you weren't sure whether to write. When you're ready, stick your notes on the board here and have a conversation about them. Make sure none of them are ignored. If you like, you can group the related ones. Has everyone had a chance to talk about the things they wrote? Now work out some agreed actions to take for future sprints based on your shared understanding.
Should we write down the actions?
This meeting could be a time to collect reflections and interpretations about how you handled that, leading to decisions and how to handle design disagreements in the future.
But our team never seems to decide anything.
We'll get to that soon.
In this example, the timeline focused only on the sprint, which would be a normal scope of a sprint retrospective meeting. In special cases, it may also be useful to expand the scope to an entire release cycle or even the team's entire history. For other ideas, see Agile Retrospectives by Esther Derby and Diana Larson, or for an earlier description, see Project Retrospectives by Norman Kurth.
It sounds like your conversation has wound down. Do you feel you've reached an understanding of each other's perspectives? Any new reflections and insights?
Yeah, I finally realized that not all Emacs users are stubborn people with left-hand carpal tunnel syndrome from typing Control-Alt-Shift-C. Only Andy is.
What was that, Mr. VI user? I didn't get that because I wasn't in text insert mode. Maybe I should get this hand looked at, though.
Okay, that was interesting. Is there any other unfinished business before we move on to decision-making?
In this case, the Scrum Master moved for closure, though in later sprints, we'd expect the team to rely on her less as her focus shifts to impediments caused by the outer organization. In either case, the team should write out a few actions to take. For the team to own their commitment to action, the Scrum Master should ask the team to do the writing. In fact, Amway Corporation discovered customers are more likely to keep purchase agreements when the customers write up the sales agreements instead of the salesman. Not all differences can be resolved, and not all teams have enough reason to stay together. Nearly all situations can be substantially improved when the group is committed to this. Small teams do have a greater probability of reaching consensus than large groups, especially when they have some control over who joins them. Congratulations, you've completed the last module in this series. If you did all the quizzes and studied the 6-page Scrum reference card, and if you're prepared to answer questions about the 4 values and the 12 principles of the Agile Manifesto, you're in good shape for anyone's Scrum class. Feel free to repeat these modules and quizzes as many times as you need to. Most of the problems people have in class or on the test are due to language differences. If you had any trouble understanding me, go through this again or contact your instructor for help. If you enjoyed these modules, or if you hated them, please drop a line with your feedback. And don't forget, someday the buzzwords will change again, but the principles will remain the same.